I am an investment banker. Five words you don't normally hear from a keynote speaker at a full race conference. But here's the thing. I built a leading global franchise advising in media and technology M&A. And if you were to list the top five attributes that led to that success, they would include creativity, storytelling, and marketing. So you see, I just want to be like you. But I want to get paid like me, okay? And at the end of the day, the essence of my presentation today, that's my message. Do what you do well and get paid better and valued better. All right, we all in agreement on that one? Let's rock this, shall we? All right, so I guess my first question was, did Mueller and Ashwini screw up by asking me to speak? I'm a little bit dangerous because, yeah, sure, I may be an experienced deal maker and know a few things about the industry. And yeah, I've told a few stories, including some jokes in the past that have gone well. But here's the thing. I'm a dangerous choice. I have no boss, no filter, and no agency clients. So kind of like Ricky Gervais, the Golden Globes, I don't care. So with that, we're going to go to the worst thing that I've done against agencies. And we're harked back 5 years to when there was this controversy. Could you imagine a controversy between agencies and their clients? Unheard of. But at the time, there was all of this hoopla about procurement, getting angry about hidden media margins, and the FBI was involved. You remember that? We were expecting a perp walk. Never happened, but I thought, how would Quentin Tarantino address this issue?
A Terence Kawaja film, Sculpt Friction, Procurement's Extreme Methods to Tame Agencies, starring Samuel L. Jackson as the procurement officer, Brett as the agency exec, John Travolta as the FBI agent, and featuring Bob Leonese as himself. Behind the scenes at the recent ANA Masters of Marketing conference.
Ezekiel 25:17. The path of the marketer is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the vendors and the tyranny of agency margins. Blessed is he who, in the name of efficiency and ROI, shepherds the media buyer through the lumiscape of darkness, for he is truly his brother's keeper and the optimizer of paid media. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my media plan. And you will know my name is Procurement when I lay my review upon thee.
So let's get into it, shall we? What I'm going to do is cover 8 major trends, and then we're going to talk about sort of how agencies can fare better against these trends. And we have a lot to cover, so please, your attention. First of all, the market environment. As Ashwini pointed out, change is everywhere. It's perpetual, and the disruption effects of it are enormous. And by the way, and change is great for my business, because at the end of the day, corporates always have strategy growth decisions. They can always build or buy, but when change happens and happens fast, they tend to default towards buy. That means more deals, and that's very good for us. But it's also good for the industry. And in fact, I would argue right now there's contradictory effects on what's going on in the marketplace. You're fully aware of all the macro uncertainties. We pretty much have everything: war, pestilence, recession, inflation, you name it. And we've had this massive tech sector sell-off in 2022 where, many companies are trading at like 70% off, pretty severe downturn, which causes a lot of disruption. But at the end of the day, we should be okay because we have these great tailwinds. We have several tailwinds. This digital advertising has got, enormous scale, growth, complexity, and dynamics, all positives. to the industry, and we have structural tailwinds. So besides the big giant technology companies, we now have 4 dozen public companies that trade in the marketplace with substantial profits and growth, and the involvement of private equity into the space, now that it's mature and has appropriate companies for it, creates a flywheel. So at the end of the day, I think we have some countervailing effects on sort of deal activity. Holy smokes. We all have to take as a given, as exogenous, what goes on from the big tech companies. And right now, there is big turmoil in big tech with 3 real themes to what's going on there. Number one, major business model changes. We're seeing companies adopt new businesses or pivot their businesses. Take a look at what Meta is trying to do. Facebook, let's call them what they really are. Then you've got rising competition. These companies largely acted as monopsonies that weren't in each other's shorts. Well, this has completely changed now, and they're overlapping in media, cloud, data, and other parts of their business, and you're gonna see some implications of that big tech clash. And let's face it, AI is a potential game changer that can really accelerate some of those overlaps. And then, of course, increasing government scrutiny on both the privacy and antitrust side. So what happens with big tech does matter, because they're so large, they have a massive effect on the ecosystem. In terms of data and identity, you're fully familiar with the phenomena that's taken place in the last few years of regulatory restrictions due to privacy on third-party data, and perhaps more importantly, a deprecation of signal from companies like Apple and Google. The cookies deprecating, the IDFA, ATT has deprecated signal on the mobile side of things, and that inhibits one-to-one targeting and much of the attributes on which digital advertising was premised. And I would say that the response to that from the industry has been twofold. Number one, workarounds. Number two, alternatives. So the workarounds are things like, okay, if third-party data is a no-no, we gotta go first-party data, but you can't share that without violating privacy, so we construct these concepts of first-party data graphs, clean rooms to be able to do that in a privacy-safe way. The problem with that workaround is that first-party data for any company, even with the largest pool of consumer data, is at best 15, maybe 20% of all addressable audiences. So first-party data doesn't scale. We still need a solution that can expand reach past first-party data pools. The alternative is a series of things, cohorts, contextual advertising. We'll see a resurgence in that, and then creative. I'm going to come back and talk more about creative, because I think that's the real opportunity for the industry. At the end of the day, the effects of this deprecation, we believe, will be to change our industry from a bifurcated one of walled gardens and open web to a trifurcated ones that include what we're describing as hedged gardens. Why hedges? Well, they're not as tall as walls, and they're more permeable. So companies in CTV, commerce media, audio, and gaming have large platforms, but not large enough to compete with the big tech companies, so they have to go off-prem or into networks to make it work. And one of those networks is commerce media. So, you know, spend is rising dramatically, that's great, all premised on the success of Amazon, who really cut their teeth in this world, and now has approaching 40 billion, will exceed 40 billion in revenue from media this year. How do they do that? They have closed loop data. They got your purchase, you know, they're there for the purchase, and they're there for the funnel on the way down. So they've got effective and efficient media. And guess what? They may have led the way, but everyone else followed. This retail media network phenomenon is incredible. Everyone's an ad network, as Eric Sufert would say. And you see it across a variety of categories. Everyone is launching a media or advertising capability. Now, why are they launching these? Well, let's see. It's a multiple choice. We're gonna go with A, improves consumer experience. B, leverages their existing assets. C, improves conversion to their core business. Or D, has way higher margins. And yes, you in the back, you got it, that's right. The answer is E, all of the above. All of these attributes are why these low-margin, high-volume companies in commerce are launching media, much better margins, and it improves the conversion to the core. In many ways, this reminds us of search and social, where you've got scale, first-party data, and sort of like an automation to the performance. The addition they have beyond big tech, beyond the walled gardens, is closed-loop attribution. So it's kind of like a perfect storm. Watch for retail media. So if you're sitting around and doing some planning, you're like, hey, is this really a thing? The answer is yes. CTV, you're familiar with this phenomenon. This is one of those categories where eMarketer has had to adjust their forecasts up to reflect the increase over what they had previously projected. And at the end of the day, the biggest benefit of CTV, the ability to target niche audiences across a media channel that heretofore was only available to large advertisers, is effectively the democratization for smaller brands. And the comparison between CBS and Facebook could not spell it out greater. CBS, 200 advertisers, Facebook, 10 million. That tells you everything you need to know. But this isn't easy. This is, in fact, not one channel. It's four channels, near as I can tell. And linear, addressable, OTT, and digital video have their own workflow parameters, their own identity currencies, and their own ad-serving technology. So that's a little bit problematic. You got to stitch all that together to make CTV work. Oh, I'm sorry. To make the CTV in my definition work. In my definition, it's not connected TV, it's convergent TV. In other words, linear TV is going to be a huge thing 5 years from now. So yes, we should focus on streaming, that's where all the heat is. But at the end of the day, linear is still going to be big for the next 5 years. So if you think about it from the marketer standpoint, they need to be able to, you know, manage their campaigns holistically across these four sub-channels. And yes, the headline here is the switch from linear to OTT. I mean, that sort of meme could not be better applied than to CTV. But and one of the things that will inflect that linear shift to streaming is sports rights, right? Because sports is like the duct tape of linear TV. It's what's holding it all together. And I predicted, I made this slide prior to December's announcement of the renewal of the Sunday Ticket, which had previously been owned by DirecTV, and sure enough, Google won that auction. Look out. Here goes an inflection point in television. And of course, on the measurement side, Nielsen was king for years. Now we have a proliferation of challenger currencies. I'm going to skip through this. This is really just a statement to say that as we move from linear to streaming, we're going to have less ad load because the ad loads are streaming, the pods are smaller, and so less inventory. And for supply constraint, in the history of American business, no one has ever left billions of dollars on the table. They are going to do what I'm calling a recategorization of other inventory as television. And you're seeing it already with YouTube. They just switched this year from the new fronts to the upfronts because what they're calling happens in YouTube on the rectangle in the living room, they're calling that TV. Look, this is hard for media companies, right? The stocks are all down with this shift because they haven't figured out the economics. And by the way, they're not going to figure out quite the economics that they used to have in the bundle. So the shift requires them effectively. It's like they're flying an airplane, and they have to switch engines mid-flight. And if they don't switch engines effectively, they're going to lose altitude. And that's exactly what's taking place in the ecosystem. Now, all the stuff being down. This is a fascinating phenomenon. You know, we have been on this march away from proxies and towards business outcomes for years now. And the companies leading the way were the gaming companies. And it was easy for them because the usage, the ads, and the conversion all happened on the same device, so they didn't have to worry about attribution. It then expanded to apps, and then you saw direct-to-consumer companies. And we'll see whether this will eventually apply to all marketers. The problem, though, with this is that in order to have a business premise on business outcomes, you have to have attribution. And Tim Cook under the guise of privacy, total bullshit, but he comes out and says, oh, I'm going to protect consumers. Bullshit. You're going to build your own ad business. Well done. But please stop with the hypocrisy. ATT has really gutted that attribution, so that's a bit of a problem. Political spin. Here's something I haven't thought of until the 2022 political cycle. Why? Because political spin in this country has now risen to $10 billion per political cycle and is rising. So if you think about the distribution of the electorate, it used to be pretty much described by a bell curve, right? Somewhere, you know, centered on the middle of the political spectrum. Well, as you I'm sure well know, America is bifurcated. It's a left and right. Well, the implications and the coincidence of that bifurcation with the rise of CTV are going to be nothing short of phenomenal. What do I mean? I mean, there is only now a niche, relatively small audience that's jump ball. So, you have a combination of a niche audience, event scarcity, right? It's the first Tuesday in November every second year, that's it, right? It's like an airplane. You can't market the seat once the plane's taken off. So if it's an empty seat, you've just wasted. So after the Tuesday, election Tuesday, there is no political advertising on the Wednesday after, or no following. LTV is up, so in this context, LTV would be the lifetime value, not of a customer, but of who controls the government, and we can all agree that the stakes are pretty damn high for that. And therefore the CAC, or the customer acquisition cost, what it costs to convert a voter, and it's not a conversion of a commerce, it's a voter, is very, very high. And this could not be more pointed out, exemplified, as the Georgia Senate runoff. Here's what I call fun with math. So it turns out that there are 7.9 million voters, registered voters in Georgia, 9% of which are independent. That leaves 704,000 voters up for jump ball. In the course of 2 months, both parties spent $238 million on that Senate runoff campaign. That's $376 per voter. If you're doing the math, that's a $376,000 CPM. You compare that to all the hoopla about Netflix's $75 CPM when they announced it's a 0.5% increase. That, ladies and gentlemen, is enough to cause Peter Naylor's eyes to bulge and watch it be. Peter, you're underselling. All right, Web 3. We're going to do this quick. Pay attention. All right, this is my realistic Web 3 glossary. I've published this on the net, so you can look up all the words later. Here's the summary. Web 3 is a made-up name. Crypto is awaiting a legitimate use case. Blockchain, real technology, but not suited for digital advertising. NFT is just a JPEG with provenance. The metaverse is a silly name. And a DAO is timeshares 2.0, same outcome. And all you need to know, and this is really important for agency people who love to jump on the latest trend and make it be their friend, zero. And that's the total return of all marketing investments made in Web3. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a scam. It's all bullshit. Don't bother with it. All right, moving on. Artificial intelligence, something that is a real trend. Obviously, you're familiar with OpenAI, with DALL-E, and all the images. I'm sure half of you, posted your amazing images. Then there's ChatGPT. That's taken the world by storm. And yes, okay, like every keynoter, fine, I'll ask, what's the biggest challenges for advertising agencies in 2023? It pointed out three things. It pointed out ad blockers, fine, that's fine. Increasing complexity of the advertising landscape, all right, and regulatory and compliance issues. So I would say not bad, but I'm going to take issue with the second one. Complexity, they are basically describing it as a challenge. I'm here to tell you, it's an opportunity. Complexity is your friend. If you think about the opportunity for AI, it's enormous, right? You combine data and AI and creative. This is where, oh my God, this kills me. This, I think, is gonna be very interesting. You can ask yourself the question, for agencies, AI is A, a threat, B, an opportunity, and of course the answer is yes. Yes, yes, it is. In fact, this is I got a bee in my bonnet on this one, but I don't have the time to go into it in full length. But here's the thing. This industry is obsessed with efficiency. Think of it as a ship approaching an iceberg. It's all about efficiency, focused on media and data. There's been millions of investments, hundreds of deals in these categories. To me, this is like missing the bigger picture. And the bigger picture is what's under the surface of the water, which is efficacy, which is primarily a creative effect. So one of them addresses cheaper, the other one better. And if there's anything to take away, this is where we need to go. And the fact that AI can now supercharge creative, I think we're in for an exciting world. Okay, so we've just gone through the trends. Now the moment of truth, ladies and gentlemen, from the LUMA University of Advanced Learning. Your report card, ladies and gentlemen. Let's go. Market environment, that's good for you. Change is good. Data and identity also. Listen, yeah, we're losing standards, but it just means more focus on intelligent intermediaries that can adapt and add value. Commerce media, this is going to be a huge boon for agencies. CTV, I'm going to go with neutral because you're losing in linear TV, which is great for you. You're picking up in CTV. So we'll call that a neutral. Phone advertising, that's really not your world. And most of the advertisers there don't utilize agencies. Political spend, good. Web3 is a loser, and I'm going to go with AI neutral. So at the end of the day, you pass. Congratulations. But hey, you passed, in other words, you survived. So maybe Rashad Tabakalol was right. Maybe you are cockroaches. By the way, I mean that as a Wall Streeter as a compliment. When I say cockroaches, that's a good thing. It means you survived nuclear war. And so I'm going to now give some prognostications. But to do that, I got to establish some bona fides. So it turns out 8 years ago, I was asked my thoughts about agencies and the future of agencies, and I wrote a guest column in Ad Age. It was called Back to Mad Men. And in it, I said the following. I'm going to do this quickly. I pointed out four companies, Axiom, Epsilon, Markle, and Neustar, as interesting companies that were bringing a lot of competition, they and AdTech, bringing a lot of competition to agencies. I said, don't consolidate, don't acquire technology, but you should acquire data marketing. Well, what happened since I published that? Dentsu bought Merkle, IPG bought Axiom, Publicis bought Epsilon, and then not agency, but TransUnion bought Neustar. So all four of those companies traded. Okay, so not bad. I also said, acquire services. And here we've seen largely, you know, S4 and the Brand Tech Group make acquisitions. And number five, and I think the one I really like, which is personified by the Accenture and Deloitte, become strategy and systems integrators. This is where there's huge value for agencies. In fact, Accenture stock is up 200% since I wrote this column, and that's double the market. So, and yes, I was in Mad Men, and maybe I should have just led with that, because as a bona fide for agencies. So, how does an agency become more valuable? Ladies and gentlemen, embrace complexity. Complexity is an opportunity, not a problem. Number two, solve the most pressing client opportunities. Yes, digital continues to grow, commerce media, CTV, there's other areas, but there's three. And one holding company I think has done a good job of this is Publicis. Look at them. Acquisition of Epsilon, acquisition of Citrus Ad, acquisition of Profitero. Three, this is really important, enhance your operating leverage with some data and technology. And there are some companies on this spectrum that do more than just the basic agency work. So here's a valuation matrix that points out differences in operating leverage based on the inherent business models. And what this ought to tell you is, I wouldn't want to be in that FTE cost plus business. Look at that, they're trading at 1.3 times revenue. That sucks. Look at the technology guys. They're in the mid singles, some of them into high double digits. Hell, into last year they were trading at double digits. So get more operating leverage, play chess, not checkers. And by the way, this is not a strategy. You can't do nothing. You got to do something. And disruption is inevitable. And to hammer that home, here is a little video I created. What is love? Baby, don't hurt me.
Luma.
What the hell's he doing here? What are you doing here? Make him stop. Try on and the music on. Is that on? Hey, give me a buddy. You got it. You know where I pay for this wedding?
What are you doing? Don't get over your head. That is so dumb. Stupid.
going. Let's go. You want to get paid? You idiot.
What were my messages from that parody video? What is love? Love is a business with substantial operating leverage that has the requisite technology foundation to maintain relevancy in a rapidly changing ecosystem. Don't hurt me by continuing a people-based FTE business model or cost-plus services model that doesn't scale. Don't hurt me no more. It's time to leverage M&A for inorganic growth into a better business model that isn't just a bully arbitrage. So, I don't know, maybe Tyler and Anthony did okay by asking me to speak. And with that, I thank you. What is love?